every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So today I want to talk to you about the seven basic human things that threaten to hold us all back. Every single one of us has experienced these seven emotions. And I even hesitate to call them emotions because they're so powerful. Each one of these things has the potential to just take us down and keep us down and hold us down. When we are held down, we can't fulfill our purpose. If we're held back, we can't fulfill our purpose. If we don't believe that we have a good purpose or that we have the capability of fulfilling it, it's never going to happen. We have to have faith in ourselves, hopefully in God. But you know what? People who don't believe in God or some kind of higher power or elegant design can still fulfill their purpose to a degree. The talents that are inside of a person and the strengths and the character traits and the personality traits that are in there that were, I believe, woven into the fabric of our being are there. We can choose to use them for good or for bad. We all have free will to do that. We can choose to pursue our purpose without cooperating and collaborating with God. He gives us the free will to do that, so I will too. So, but it doesn't matter what you believe or don't believe. You're a human being, and we've all experienced these things that can derail us for a time or for the whole time we're in this life. So that's what we want to talk about today. The very first one is rejection, the feeling of being unloved, unwanted, as though we don't belong. Man, it's hard. It really hurts. It can take over your mind, literally hurt your heart, literally hurt your body. Or not. We don't have to allow rejection or any of these other things or any other emotion that we ever feel or any other situation that we ever experience. We don't have to allow these things to hold us back. As a matter of fact, the opposite of that is true. We can use every one of these things and any other challenge, obstacle, setback that we ever experience, we can use those things as the stepping stones to the successful fulfillment of our purpose. So it's important that we understand that point. Before I go on to number two, we have to understand it's not a fait accompli that we're going to experience these things and be destroyed by them. We can experience rejection, heal, get over it, move on, move forward, and have an amazing life. And many of us, many of you listening now, know that that's true because you're living in a time post-rejection. You can accept yourself and heal yourself by loving yourself. That's okay. Somebody else's opinion of you or me is their problem. It's their opinion. Doesn't define you or me. Okay, number two, the second of the seven wounds that we all experience in our life at some point in time. This is a really powerful one. It's shame. Shame is, I'll just say, let's see, embarrassment to the 100th power. None of us wants to be embarrassed. But shame happens when you go beyond embarrassment and you truly begin to believe that there's something bad about you. Or not just about you, but that you are bad. It's a horrible feeling. And again, it's resolved by accepting yourself and loving yourself and believing that there's good about you. So much of what I talk about in this Find Your Purpose Now podcast is the goodness that's in you. And the reason for that is that, you know, we've all had people who, you know, they don't like us for one reason or another. They don't support us. They don't see the good in us. And, you know, when we're from the time we're born, from the time we're little bitty babies, we look up into the eyes of the person holding us, and that's where we get our self-esteem. If the person holding you when you were a little bitty baby looked down at you smiling and saying, "Oh my gosh, you're so amazing. I love you. You're the best thing that ever happened to me." You believe that about yourself often throughout your life. So that when somebody else rejects you and somebody else takes a moment of embarrassment and extrapolates it all the way out to not that it was a moment in time that you walked out of the bathroom with your zipper on, whatever it is, but that it turns into you're no good. If the person who held us as a baby looked down and thought we were the most amazing thing that ever happened on earth, we will have the intestinal fortitude to be able to say, I'm sorry you don't like me. I like me. And we move on. But if the person who held you when you were a baby was nervous, stressed, sick, frustrated, didn't want you, or had something wrong with them. Maybe the person was, you know, had a substance abuse disorder or a personality disorder. And that person looked down and said, "Oh my gosh, this is, you know, I don't even know how I'm going to raise this kid. And this is not what I planned for. This is not what I signed up for." Well, you know, even as little bitty babies, when we don't have language, we can pick up on facial expressions. We pick up on energy. We pick up on negativity. And so that feeling of not being wanted, not being loved, not being good enough, not being enough, period, will carry over so that when somebody comes along and believes that there's something bad about you, it connects with that primitive time when you had no words, when someone who should have given you positive self-esteem implanted the seed inside of you that something was wrong with you or something was bad about you. Every other time there's shame or rejection, that comes back up until you decide to love yourself, to find what's good about you. That's why I talk about this all the time in this podcast, about your good character traits, your strength, your resilience, your courage, your tenacity. Maybe it's your patience. Maybe it's your ability to listen well to others, to make others feel seen and heard. Whatever these good things are about you, you know what they are. When you feel that shame, that wound, that rejection, think about your goodness The third wound, hopelessness. We've all lost hope at some point or another. We lose hope that a relationship is ever going to get better. We lose hope, let's say we lose a job and we don't know if we're going to get the next job, when we're going to get the next job. And as time goes by and you go on interview after interview and submitting application after application and you don't get called and you don't get hired, that loss of hope can turn into hopelessness. The counter to that is to remember times when things did go well. A time before when you did get hired. A time before when you felt very hopeful about your future. You really can create and empower hope within yourself. And if you need help with that, you find a friend, a neighbor, a relative, a coworker, somebody, a pastor, a therapist, somebody who will help you by loaning their hope to you until you have your own again. The fourth wound is abandonment. Now, you know, some of us have experienced real physical abandonment. I had a gal tell me a horrible story of what happened to her, where she was moving and she had packed everything that she had into this boyfriend's car. And the last thing that, you know, was going in was just her carry-on luggage with her immediate stuff and her handbag. And so she turned around to pick that up and the boyfriend drove away with everything she owned. I mean, that's real abandonment. But we've all experienced a feeling of abandonment. Maybe when your parents divorced. Maybe when someone passed away, someone you loved passed away. It can be not being invited to the party. That can really hurt. It can be overlooked for a promotion. It's a sense of being unseen and unheard and alone in those feelings. So the counter to a feeling of abandonment is to connect with at least one other person who does see you, who does hear you. Understanding that you're not alone in the world. It's so powerful. And for people of faith, I know for me, even when I'm physically alone or I'm dealing with something big that nobody else can help me with, I'm not alone. I know that I'm not alone. I have Jesus with me. I invited Jesus into my heart. There he is. And he promised to never leave me nor forsake me. And, you know, if you want to give that a shot, all you have to do is invite him in. And he's not a human being who will eventually hurt you. And, you know, not to say every human being will intentionally hurt you, but people are human and we make mistakes and we say dumb things and, you know, forget birthdays and, you know, things like that. But you don't have to be alone. The fifth wound is fear. We've all felt it. The feeling of fear leads to vigilance, a feeling that I have to protect myself. I have to be distrustful of others. I have to be skeptical. Your body tenses up. Your breathing can become shallow. Your thinking can become very hyper-focused on whatever is the cause of the fear. And unfortunately, that can happen to the exclusion of everything else. So, you know, how that and anything else can prevent you from living your purpose. is if you're wrapped up in fear, you're thinking about the things that you're fearful of. You're thinking about the worst possible scenario, the horrible things that can happen to you. If this happens, that terrible thing is going to happen. When you're doing all that, you're not thinking about your purpose. You're not strategizing about what move comes next. You're not praying and asking for guidance and wisdom about which choice you should make. Fear is really a powerful deterrent to the fulfillment of our purpose. The counter to fear. Well, first of all, breathe. And it's not, I'm not trying to be flippant about that, but I experienced a lot of fear growing up. And I know for me, I would hold my breath. Well, when you're breathing is shallow, you're just literally not getting enough oxygen to your brain. When you slow down, take a deep breath, exhale slowly, fill up your lungs again, and do that for a bit. Just give yourself a minute. Get some oxygen into your brain. And let that oxygen carry throughout your body. You really can help yourself to just de-escalate, just dial down the fear. Drink water. I have it with me constantly. So I think we probably, most of us don't get enough water, but hydrate. Get that hydration in there. And then really just think, at least this is what I do. Mental health professionals probably have all kinds of great suggestions for how to alleviate fear in your life. For me, I think about, okay, what's the worst thing that can happen in this situation? All right, if that happens, what's the worst ramification of that? Okay, if that happens, what's the worst thing that can happen? And go down the line on that. And even in the worst case scenario, if you can envision yourself living through it, figuring it out, you don't have to like it. It doesn't have to feel great. It might be uncomfortable. It might even be a little bit painful. But if you can begin to see yourself surviving your worst case scenario, and by the way, you've survived all your worst days so far, chances are you're going to survive the next thing that happens. You can begin to get it under control and take steps to manage the risk of the fearful thing happening. When you manage the risks and the realities that you face in your life, you take back control. And I think we're happy and functional in our lives and moving toward our purpose to the degree that we feel that we're in control. When things are outside of our control, it feels fearful. So whatever you can do to take control of your situation or the specific things that cause you fear, the better off you'll be. Number six, powerlessness. This is horrible. Well, they're all horrible, but we've all felt powerless at some point in our lives or another. And I'm sorry to say that if you haven't, you will. It's a feeling of okay, like for me, when my best friend had cancer and she was in her last days and I was still praying for a miracle. And then she had the temerity to go ahead and go to heaven. And I felt powerless throughout the last couple of months of her life. I kept praying, but I felt powerless to do anything. When somebody that you love is hurting and you can't do a darn thing about it, you feel powerless. If you're in, let's say, a toxic relationship, if you've ever been in a toxic relationship and you feel trapped, you feel like you can't get out, or you're in a terrible job that you hate, and but you know it pays the bills and you don't see any other jobs available and you feel trapped, or when you feel vulnerable to somebody else who seems to have, you know, hold all the cards, that feeling of powerlessness is awful. But the counter to that is to take your power back. And you can begin to take your power back right where you are, no matter where you are, no matter what the circumstances are. And it goes back to what I just said about the last one. You control the air you breathe. You control the water you take in. You control, for the most part, whether or how much you move and get your blood flowing. You control your thoughts. You control your attitude. You control the words that come out of your mouth. You control your actions, your behavior. You control the choices that you make, for the most part. When you take your control back, whatever even little modicum of control that you can take, you are directly influencing that feeling, that emotion of being powerless. And you're basically saying, nope, not today. I'm taking my power back. The last one is confusion. We've all felt a feeling of confusion, like we can't make sense of a situation. We can't figure it out. Confusion often leads to overwhelm. It can be as simple as, I don't know which of my friends to go out with Friday night, or I don't know which job I should take, or I don't know which, you know, where I should live, or I don't know what to do next. This is a big one with finding your purpose. I don't know the next step to living my purpose. That feeling of confusion basically makes us freeze, stop in place. And when we do that, obviously, we're not moving forward. We're not taking control. I can tell you that for me, countering confusion begins with prayer. I'm asking God all the time, every day, many times a day, okay, what are we doing next? Who am I supposed to call? Who am I supposed to text? Who do you want me to meet with? Where do you want me to go? Because every time you say yes to one thing, you're saying no to everything else. So I'm always trying to seek guidance on what among the zillion options and opportunities is the right one. I don't want to get confused. So I start with prayer. But another thing that you can do is, you know, the old Ben Franklin method of, you know, make a T diagram and put the advantages on one side and the disadvantages on the other side of each choice or each situation and how you can respond to it. And it's a logical approach to dealing with whatever it is that's confusing you. So those are the seven emotions. And maybe there are more than that, but the seven primary that we all deal with, that any one of which threatens to distract us and diminish the fulfillment of our purpose. Don't let this happen to you. You have control. You might not think you do, but you do. You have the ability to deal with every one of these emotions successfully. And once you do, you then have a template, you have a strategy for dealing with every other thing that ever comes up. And they will, because, you know, this is life. And I'll just add one more thing. Trying to push down the feelings, manage the feelings, maybe with unhealthy coping skills, you know, self-medicating, alcohol, pills, whatever. I mean, for some of us, it's not that, you know, it'd be shopping or eating a gallon of ice cream or whatever it is. But pushing down and trying to manage all those kind of things, they never really work. They might in the moment, but it's not sustainable. It's not a strategy that will work long term to help you have the life that you deserve to have, that purposeful life that includes healthy relationships and peace and joy and a sense of wellness and financial stability, all those things that come with doing what you were made to do. So that's it. I just want to encourage you, decide. It is a decision that you're not going to allow any of these kinds of emotions, challenges, obstacles to hold you back. You're going to take control. You're going to counter all these things that threaten to diminish your purpose, your story, you. Decide. You're not going to let it happen. All right, I'll see you next week. Thanks for joining me today.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.